Good morning, Solid Rock Church. I invite you to stand as we engage in worship this morning. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Come on, this is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Well, good morning. How many would you agree that his grace is truly amazing this morning, huh? Hey, you could be seated, all right? Thank you so much for being here this morning. You might see a bunch of us walking around this morning with name tags on. This is first of two Get to Know You Sundays. And so we're trying to keep smallness and largeness. And so if you would just, I know it's already the second service, but afterwards, if you would just find the name tag in the lobby here or the Church Street's entrance or downstairs, if you're going to stick around afterwards, just put a name tag on just so we can get to know who you are. We would love to know you by your first name. And also in the fellowship hall, we're taking pictures. So I know I forced some of you to go there early this morning between services. Don't make me find you and make you go down there, all right? Just stop down there. We have an internal church directory. We don't do this big Olin Mills church directory that everybody gets a copy of. But internally, we want to put a name with a face to get to know you better. And so if you would do that for us after the service, we would greatly appreciate. We're doing it next week as well. So make sure you come back if you didn't get it today and take part next week as well. It is so great to have every one of you here today. If you are new with us today, and I know we have some new people who are here with us, we would love to acknowledge you are here. In your seat back pocket is an information card. And you can simply fill that out for us. Or go to our church app and you can fill it out as well. Just let us know who you were. We would love to let you know how grateful we are that you are here today. You can take that, drop it in the freestanding boxes and back. Also, that information card is a way to share with us your prayer needs. If there's something we can pray for you, your family, someone in your circle of influence, we would love to do that. We take time every week as a church staff to pray for our church family. We would love to include you this week. Also, if you came prepared to give today, those giving boxes in back are the same way. Drop it in there. You can also see on the screen electronic ways to give as well. We have a discipleship class coming up that's going to begin a week from Monday. As you know, you've heard so many times from Brad or our teaching team, we want to grow people to reach people. And one of the ways we can do that is through our discipleship classes. We have a class starting a week from Monday called Who is God? And we would love for you to consider taking part in that. It will help you in your spiritual journey, help you know more about God and who he is, his character, how he fits into your life. Please consider coming to that. Go to the website. You can register there. Also find out more information about the class. All right. It's October. But there's a few things coming up soon. One is going to be our Thanksgiving praise service. We're not that long away from it. We are changing it this year from a Sunday night to a Tuesday night. The Tuesday of Thanksgiving week, we would love for you to consider coming out that night. It would be a night for us to just share what God has done in the life of our church family over this past year. You'll hear a devotional from Brad. We're going to have extended time of praise and worship together. It's going to be a wonderful night. And if that didn't already maybe want you want to come, we have desserts afterwards. All right, so you'll want to come for that as well. If you have not experienced the incredible desserts of this church family, you will want to be here that night to experience those. So please come out that night. Now listen, this next announcement might trigger some of you, but Christmas is coming around the corner too, all right? A not-so-silent night is coming up. It's a family Christmas event, a time for crafts, games, foods, a movie together. That's going to be on Saturday the 2nd. Please consider coming to that. It'll be a great time as we take this fall and we grow together as a church family. Would you stand with me again as we continue to praise and worship our great God?
Friend, and I have lived in the goodness of Convicted this week. I was convicted because I think I was just worried too much about the details, you know? I'm a month into this position, and I get caught up in, you know, taking inventory or making sure the sound is where I want it to be and all these things, and I missed Jesus in those moments. I miss being at the foot of Jesus. I don't know if anyone can relate to that. Can anyone relate to that? Getting caught up in the details. Chaos of life going on, gotta take kids to school, gotta do all these different things, grocery shop, meal plan. And I was reminded Tuesday morning when I was just spending some time with God, and I opened up to John chapter 12, and it says this in verse 3. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it in Jesus' feet and wiped it with her hair, and the house was filled with a fragrance of perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth about a year's wages. And Jesus responds with this, verse 7. Leave her alone. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. And I read that, and I could relate to Judas. It's usually not a good thing to relate to Judas. But I could relate to Judas in that moment. I say, man, how many times am I caught up in the details, caught up in the things of life that get going on, and I miss the Mary, and I miss those moments where I say, hey, you're at the feet of Jesus. Like, just be present, regardless of all this chaos that's going on. Can you have the chaos in life go on and still be present in those moments? And so that just leads us to this next time in worship, Lord, that I would just pray, Father, that regardless of the chaos and the things that go on, that you would reign above it all. Lord, that we would worship and glorify you, regardless of the things that distract us in this life, Lord. I pray that you would reign above it all. Lord, let that be our prayer.
The reign of darkness now has ended. In the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of light. Forever under your dominion, you're the king of my life. You're the king of my life. You reign above it all, you reign above. And over every heart, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. On the cross, the work was finished. God, you poured out your life just to give us new life. Now from the lips of the forgiven, the darkness running out of an empty grave.
now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You set the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You set the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You set the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You set the darkness running out of an empty grave. Now seated of the chaos, the crazy mess that we have going on in our life, Lord, that you would reign. Lord, I pray that we would not miss being in your presence, that we wouldn't move on with life and let the world and the distractions and the chaos of life just miss those moments of you, whether that's talking to a friend and engaging in a conversation or spending time with our kids. Lord, I pray that over everything in our life that you reign. We praise and worship you this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, we are trying to glean and learn from the life of Joseph. We're in Genesis chapter 40 today, so I hope you'll turn in your copy of the scriptures to Genesis 40. But we're trying to understand what it is that is going on in Joseph's life. He's going through crazy messes or crazy mess, and he's succeeding. And so how do we learn to succeed and find success in our crazy mess that we might be in? And Joseph continues to go up, and then he goes down, right? And so we relate to that because we go through good times, and then things seem to tank on us, and we're right there in a bad time. This week, I was listening to some sports. Anybody do that with me? I love it when they talk about these guys, these pro athletes, kind of like, you know, they came out of nowhere, but when they didn't. But they talk about a couple things typically. They talk about, they've used words like tangible and intangible. And something I picked up on this week, I noticed that when they talk about the tangibles, they're talking about their talents, their skills, what they can do on the field. And when they talk about the intangibles, of course, there's more to this than what I'm going to point out, but they consistently talk about a person's character. And some guys, they can't say that about, so they don't. But the guys that they do are able to say that about, they like to point that out, that he has those intangibles. And they're talking about character. And I want you to think about people in your life that you've met that are highly talented, highly skilled people, maybe have a lot of charisma and a lot to offer, but you've watched their lives implode because they couldn't back up their skill set with character. Maybe you were close to them. Maybe some of the carnage, you got, you know, tied up in the carnage of that, and I've experienced that. Maybe you've experienced that in your lives. Maybe you've been that person. Maybe you've been that person that was really impressive on the outside, but weren't able to back it up with your character, and so you caused a whole lot of issues and problems for yourself and for those that are impacted in your life. You see, when we left off last week, we left Joseph, who was wrongfully accused and put in prison. And what I love about the life of Joseph is he doesn't seem to be taking any shortcuts. He's taking all the long cuts. And the difference between a long cut and a shortcut is your character. It's easy to take shortcuts when you're not concerned about what God is doing in you, and your only concern is about what God is doing through you. But understand this, if you're a Christian and you say, I want to bring glory to God with my life. I mean, if we were having a concert here, you would jump up and down and be like, I want to bring glory to God with my life. If that's you, and it should be you, you should want to bring glory to God with your life. Understand that God will want to work in you as much, if not more, than he wants to work through you to bring him glory. That the work that he's doing in you is to bring him glory. He's changing you. He's molding you. He's chipping away at you. He's making you more and more like his son, Jesus Christ. And that process of sanctification in our lives is hard sometimes. It's difficult to go through sometimes, but it is how God brings glory and gets glory in our lives. And the more he's getting glory as he does work in us, the more he can get glory to work through us. And we're going to see this transformation even in the life of Joseph today, even just the text that we're in chapter 40 and 41. You see, when we take shortcuts in character, we become caricatures of ourselves. We become caricatures of the goals and the plans and the dreams that God has for us to bring him glory. You know what a caricature is, don't you? It's an exaggeration of self. And when we become that, we miss out on the work that God is doing in us for his glory as well as through us for his glory. And Joseph seems to understand that. I'm not saying that he's got it all together. I'm saying he seems to really understand the opportunities that God has for him in prison. He's in a pit. And so if you're in a pit this morning, if you're in a metaphorical pit, if life is the pits right now, you can relate to Joseph because he's in a pit, literally in a pit in the prison below ground. It's not fun, but he understood there's opportunities to seize. An opportunist, let me define an opportunist for you from the dictionary, is someone who adapts the practice of adapting decisions, etc. So this is a person who is an opportunist who can adapt to adapting and making decisions inside of that. They're able to change on the fly. Oh, you want me to be this? I can be that. It goes on to say, to expediency without regard to moral principles or consequences. So this person is an opportunist, doesn't even care whether it's morally or ethically right or what the consequences come. If it's an opportunity, I'm going to take it. I'm going to run with it because it's good for me, regardless of the consequences. Now, Let me point out, you don't want to be an opportunist according to this definition. You want to be like Joseph, who understood opportunity is different than being an opportunist. And so let me give a definition of opportunity from the dictionary: a condition favorable for attainment of a goal or a good chance as for success. And Joseph, we're going to see him take an opportunity today and seize that opportunity. And of course, one of his goals, being in jail, what do you think one of his goals were? Get out of jail, all right? That was one of his goals. And so we're going to see that as a good chance or as for success. But in the midst of that, God asked him to wait longer than he would like. We're going to see his age change. You know, last week we talked about he was in Potiphar's house as a slave. When he got in the house, he was 17. And he said by the time he was thrown in jail, what was he, 18, 19, 20? I don't know how many years passed, but maybe 1, 2, 3 years. He's in jail as a 20-year-old. And so he's going to spend over a decade as a slave and as a prisoner. The late part of his teens and 20s. And we're going to talk about the word success and defining it more next week, but today I want to give you a made-up definition, not from the dictionary, but hopefully made up from the life of Joseph here in the text from the Bible, all right? So here it is. Success is to be used by God in a way that brings him glory. I think this was his definition of success. Because no matter what happened, no matter it was good or bad, he just wanted to be used by God, or it seemed that he was being used by God and was open to that for God's glory. It really wasn't, and he was learning about that. So let's look at Genesis 40, verse 1. It says, sometime after this, he got thrown into prison, all right? Sometime after this, the cupbearer of the king of Egypt and the chief and his baker committed an offense against the Lord of the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh was angry with the two officers and the chief cupbearer and the chief baker. So here we have in the first two verses the fact that Pharaoh isn't happy with two of his right-hand men. Why do we know the right-hand men? Well, because the cupbearer, what did he do? He like basically produced wine, made wine, and said, here, Pharaoh, this is safe to drink. I'm your cupbearer. Come bringing and bearing your cup. And so Pharaoh trusted this guy with his life. Chief Baker as well, what did he do? He made food. So these guys are in charge of eating and drinking. Not bad. Not bad jobs, but they lost their jobs because Pharaoh's angry with them. So there's some sort of conspiracy. There's some sort of threat. Maybe Pharaoh just didn't even like the meal. He's like, this meal's terrible. You're going to jail. I don't know what it was. I don't know if there was like rumor that someone did something or there was somebody poisoned. But what you're going to find out in the story is that one seems to be innocent and the other seems to be guilty in whatever Pharaoh thought. But he throws them, they're somehow tied together because eating and drinking go so hand in hand. They're thrown into jail. And so, verse 3 tells us, and he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard. And if we've been paying attention, who is the captain of the guard? Whose house is this? Potiphar. Good. You guys are on it, man. You must have got up and read your Bible this morning. You're ready to go. Potiphar's house. Potiphar is the captain of the guard where Joseph was the slave, and so he was thrown into his jail. The captain of the guard has his own private jail. Makes sense? He's the captain of the guard, so like, why should he trudge people all the way across town to keep up? He's just going to throw them in a jail in his house, all right? So he's got a pit somewhere in his house where he keeps these people, and the cupbearer and the chief baker are thrown there into jail. This was where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard appointed Joseph to be with them. Huh? They needed babysitting. I don't know. What's going on here? Potiphar says, hey guys, they're probably friends. Think about if you got the right-hand man, the cupbearer, he's close to Pharaoh, right? The chief baker, he's pretty close to Pharaoh. He's a right-hand guy to Pharaoh. And who else is a right-hand guy to Pharaoh? Captain of the guard. He is the captain of all those guards for Pharaoh. And so most likely what's happening here, why Joseph is being brought into this is because Potiphar's like, hey guys, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to put Joseph in charge of you, and it's going to go good for you. Like, I know you're in jail, and this is not good, but I know that Joseph is going to take good care of you. And he attended them. They continued for some time in custody. Don't you love that from God's word right there? It's just some time. They're doing time. How much time? We all be like, am I done yet? Am I done yet? Am I done yet? But we don't know how much time. Verse 5. And on the night that they, one night they both had dreamed, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning, he saw that they were troubled. And so they both have a dream one night. Some time has gone by. He's been taking care of them for a while. He's building a relationship with them. He sees them the next morning, and they're both troubled. And he's like, what's going on? Verse 7. So he asked Pharaoh's officers who are with him in custody in his master's house, why are your faces downcast today? He's like, well, they're like, well, we had nightmares. We had dreams. No. He says to them, we had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them. Now, typically in the story, we move on and say, and Joseph said to them, do not interpretations belong to God? Good for Joseph. He knows they come from God. Please tell them to me. And we kind of like glance over this question, but the question of the statement is that they're upset, they're downcast because no one can interpret their dreams. There's no one here to interpret our dreams. Meaning, when they lived in Pharaoh's house, there were guys. There were magicians, astrologers, you know, dream interpreters, whatever they were called. There were guys. And there were guys who interpreted dreams, and then they were able to rub shoulders with those guys. Like, they had a lot of privilege when they lived in Pharaoh's house. And if they had a dream, they always be like, hey, man, I had this dream. Can you interpret it for me? And even if the guys didn't know what they meant, they would lie to them, and they would tell them whatever they thought was best for the circumstances that fit. If you don't believe me, wait until you read chapter 41, because Pharaoh has a dream. He goes to his interpreters, and they're all lying to him, like, well, it probably means this. And Pharaoh's like, doesn't mean that. That isn't even close, right? And so here they are in jail, and they're like, man, we don't have our guys to interpret this dream for us, but we both had some pretty wicked dreams, and we want to know what they mean. And so I love Joseph's response. Watch this. He says, do not interpretations belong to God? Please tell them to me. Now, we're going to see Joseph grow in the next chapter. From this point to when he gets to Pharaoh's dream, he says to Pharaoh, Pharaoh's like, interpret my dream. He's like, it's God, not me, man. But here he's saying, okay, the interpretations belong to God. Tell them to me. And he sees an opportunity to be used by God in this situation. And so right now, wherever you're at, even if it's jail, whatever pit you're in, God is in these circumstances, and he wants to show up, and he wants you to seize an opportunity to bring him glory, to be used by him and to bring him glory. And no matter what kind of crazy mess you find yourself in today, God is present, and he wants to use you for his glory. And so you got to learn how to recognize and seize these opportunities like Joseph has done. It's interesting because Potiphar and the jailkeeper, both guys trusted Joseph with so much that they weren't concerned about running their household, their field, or a jail cell. Why? Why did they trust Joseph? Well, because he was so skilled. He had that, you know, that thing, that it thing. He had that it factor. He had charisma. He, you know, people liked him. No. I'm sure they knew a lot of guys like that that they didn't trust. I'm sure you have known a lot of people like that that you don't trust, or that you shouldn't trust, or that you've been burned trusting, right? Why did they trust Joseph? I believe they trusted Joseph because of his character. In fact, in the Potiphar chapter 39, it even tells us that the Potiphar understood that Joseph was following God, and that God was making him succeed, and therefore his household was being blessed. That he understood that Joseph had a reputation of being someone of character, but a character because of his God. So my question for us this morning is, if God is growing us in character, are you even known for it? Are you telling people about it? Are you seizing opportunities to be used by God in other people's lives? Are you someone that people trust because they see your character, and more importantly than your character, they see your character is there because of your God? This is Joseph, and this is what we learn from him in this situation. We need to seize the opportunities to be used by God that are found in the midst of our circumstances, whatever it is, whatever you're going through. You need to seize those opportunities to be used by him for his glory. We're told in the scriptures that Joseph at this point is 28 years old, and that he's going to interpret these, when he's about to interpret these guys' dreams. Verse 9, so the chief cupbearer told his dream to Joseph and said to him, "In my dream there was a vine before me, and the vine was there three branches. As soon as it budded, it blossomed and shot forth, and clusters ripened into grapes." And so what is the cupbearer dreaming about? Wine. He's dreaming about grapes. He's dreaming about his job. He's dreaming about being restored. Look at verse 11. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes and pressed them into Pharaoh's cup and placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand. Oh, if I could just get back to out of the prison and doing my job. That's what he's dreaming about. If you don't like your job, this is a good thing to think about. If you don't like your job and you don't like your circumstances, go spend some time in jail for a while, and you might be dreaming about going back to your job. Okay? That's what's happening for the cupbearer here. Look at verse 12. Then Joseph said to him, this is the interpretation. The three branches are 3 days. In 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your office, and you shall go. You shall place Pharaoh's cup in his hand as formerly you, when you were his cupbearer. You're going to be lifted up out of this pit. This is the interpretation. In 3 days, and you're going to get your job back with Pharaoh. It's going to be awesome. Now, ironically, if you have prepared and read ahead, like you know, some of you did this morning, I know it. What else is happening in 3 days? Why is this significant? In 3 days, what's happening? Why is Pharaoh gonna lift up the cupbearer? He's gonna do the same thing with Chief Baker as well. What's Pharaoh doing in 3 days? He's celebrating his birthday. Yeah, so he needs a cake, and he needs a chief baker, and he needs some wine, right? He needs to throw a party for himself, and so he's gonna raise these guys up, But Joseph has no clue about this, and he is interpreting the dream. Look at verse 14. He says, only remember me when it's well with you. So when you get back to your job and everything's going well for you, don't forget me, he says. Mention me to Pharaoh, and so get me out of this house. For I was indeed stolen out of the land of the Hebrews, and here also I have done nothing that they should put me into the pit. What is Joseph doing here? He's saying, cupbearer, you and me, we're in the same set of circumstances. According to your dream, you're going to be rescued. You don't deserve to be here. I don't deserve to be here. I'm just a Hebrew guy that ended up being a slave, and now I'm thrown in, wrongfully accused. I'm in jail with you. And so he says, when you get to Pharaoh and everything's going your way again, please mention me to Pharaoh, like, I don't want to be here anymore. Understandable. But definitely a human moment for Joseph that we would all relate to, like, yeah, don't forget me. Verse 16, when the chief baker saw that the interpretation was favorable, how do you like that? Oh, that sounds pretty good. I want some of that. You're going to get out? I want to get out too. He says, I also had a dream. There were three cake baskets on my head, and in the uppermost basket, there were all sorts of baked foods for Pharaoh, but the birds were eating out of it, out of the basket on my head. Okay, that's weird. Verse 18, and Joseph answered and said, this is it, the interpretation. The three baskets are 3 days, and in 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head from you. So like the first guy was like, I'm gonna lift up your head. That's like good news. That means your whole self, you know. This man's like, Pharaoh's gonna lift up your head from you, from your body. He's just gonna attach it, and then he's gonna hang you in a tree, and the birds are gonna come eating flesh from you. He's like, wait a second, what happened to the good interpretation, the favorable one? That doesn't sound good at all. And so it's not. And quite possibly, we don't really know the whole back story of all this, but, you know, the chief baker might have been found that he was the problem with whatever situation that Pharaoh had thrown the two of them into jail for in the first place. But here Joseph is, and in the midst of these two interpretations, in the midst of these two dreams, interpreting for these two guys, he says, don't forget me. Remember me when you get to Pharaoh. Like, I want to get out of here. And I don't know how long you've been going through what you're going through, and maybe you're like Joseph, and you're saying, God, I need deliverance. I need to get out of this pit, and I need to get out of this pit yesterday. And maybe you relate to that, and I know I do. In fact, waiting on God is one of the most difficult things that you can do in your Christian walk. Is say, God, I know you want to deliver me, but you aren't delivering me, and you haven't delivered me yet. And I'm waiting on deliverance. What do we do in those moments? What did Joseph do in this moment? Continue to trust God that he has a plan, and he has a purpose, and he has some other bigger, greater thing that he's doing. In fact, we're going to read on in a minute, and we're going to find out that Joseph spends two more years in prison. And so in those 2 years, what is God doing? He's molding and making. And yet he's watched the cupbearer now be pulled out of prison. And even the chief baker, he's going to watch get pulled out of prison, even though it's not going to work out for him. I'm like, why does that guy get to get out and I don't? You ever wonder things like that? You ever wonder why others experience the blessings you so desperately need? I got really good news for you. God has a plan. There's a reason why. There's a reason why they are getting their relief and you're not. There's a reason why they're seeing deliverance and you're not. There's a reason why their life is going a certain way and yours is not. There's a reason, because God has a plan and he has timing and it's for his glory. Understand that Joseph wants to bring glory to God. He wants to be used, and he wants to seize opportunities to be used by God for his glory. But part of that waiting is, part of that process of waiting is, God is continuing to chip away and mold his character. And you're going to see that a little bit in the rest of the storyline. Verse 20, on the third day, which was Pharaoh's birthday. There you go. You just read ahead. All right. He made a feast for all his servants and lifted up the head of the chief cupbearer and the head of the chief baker among his servants. Verse 21, he restored the chief cupbearer to his position and he placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand. But he hanged the chief baker as Joseph had interpreted to them. Yet the chief, verse 23, yet the chief cupbearer did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. Yikes, not good. Have you ever noticed that sometimes when you seize an opportunity to be used by God and you say, God, I want to bring you glory with my life, that sometimes God is using you, and when God is using you, also people are using you? Ever experienced that? Say, God, I'm so glad to be used by you. And says, yeah, but some people are going to use you too. They're going to jump into this situation and take advantage. They're going to take these circumstances and they're going to come up with their own things. And so here you see, Joseph feeling a little used. Like, I did the interpreting, you know. Why can't you just remember me for that? But he has been forgotten. The chief cupbearer is forgotten, and two more years are going to go by. But I got good news. God did not forget Joseph. And even though he was there two more years in prison, God used that to grow him and in his character so that he could bring great glory to God when he stood before Pharaoh. And so chapter 41, verse 1 says, after 2 whole years, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile, and then it tells you his dream, and his dream's about 7 cows. There's fat cows, and there's skinny cows, and then 7 grains of corn, and it's like, okay, well, what does all this mean, right? And Pharaoh's upset. He's like, I've had this weird, whacked-out dream, and I need an interpretation, and he goes to interpreters, and then he's like, nope. You guys, they couldn't do it. They couldn't interpret his dream for him. And so in verse 9, it tells us that the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, I remember my offenses today. He's like, stupid me. I forgot to tell you, Pharaoh, there is a guy in jail a couple years ago that interpreted my dream and the chief baker's dream. And guess what? They both came true. And it's interesting that you had the positive outcome and the negative outcome, right? You got the guy being hanged and the guy being restored. Imagine if they had both been good, favorable dream interpretations. How much credit would they have given Joseph? None. They would have been like, yeah, it was coincidence, right? Everything turned out okay because everything was fine all along, right? But obviously it wasn't fine because he had 2 different interpretations, and it was very clear that, man, he nailed both of those. How could he have known that one guy would be restored and one guy would hang from a tree and the birds would eat out of his body? Because it was God. Verse 16. Oh, so back up. Sorry. He says, I remember my offenses today. A young Hebrew who was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard, you know, that Potiphar guy, when we told him, he interpreted our dreams to us, giving an interpretation to each man according to his dream. And so what happens? 2 years later, Pharaoh says, get me that guy. And he pulls him out of the pit, and he gives him a chance to take a shower and shave and get cleaned up and get some clothes, nice clean clothes on. And he says, bring him into my presence, bring him to me so that he can interpret my dream. And so he says to Joseph, interpret my dream. And Joseph answers in verse 16, it is not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. He says, it's not me. It's not in me, but it's God. And so this is just a small tweak from the last time when the cupbearer approached Joseph. Joseph's like, well, God's the interpreter of dreams. Tell it to me. And he interprets it, and he's like, don't forget me. Don't forget about me. And so he's a little like hung up on me at the moment, but look at the growth. This is the king of Egypt, who is also basically the king of the world, because Egypt is the dominant power in the world at the time. And he says to Pharaoh, he must make it very clear, it's not even in me to do it. I did it, but it wasn't me. What's he doing? He's averting all attention and glory to self, and he's giving it all to God. To who? The king of the world at the time. He wants Pharaoh to know very clearly, it's not in me. It's not me, it's God. And so those 2 years developed his character in a way that those extra 2 years in jail that God was waiting to bring him glory so that he could clearly say to Pharaoh, it's not me, it's God. And I want you to think about your own life. I want you to think about the opportunities that you've seized to bring glory to God, and people have noticed, and people have come to you, and they say things like, wow, man, you really do that great, or you really do that well, and you're like, yeah, I kind of do. Right? Isn't that what we do? Yeah. I am pretty awesome. And what does God have to do to mold us and to make us in our character where we can get to the point that Joseph got to where he can say, listen, man, it's not me. It's not even in me. It's totally God. It's 100% God that we not only divert attention and glory from ourselves to God, to the rightful person, but we have a testimony, a witness of God's work and power in our lives that, yes, I've seen God use me and do great things, and it's God has worked in me and through me and to bring him glory, but I want you to know that he's the one. It's not me. It's him that you need to know. And he'll be able to help you the way he has helped me in my life, because it's not me. It's God. And so in verse 16, he interprets the dream for Pharaoh, or he says he's going to, and we're going to see that next week. But no matter what kind of crazy mess you're in, we're trying to find the Joseph's way to success. And crazy mess success involves recognizing opportunities from God and seizing them for his glory. That when opportunities come, we've got to recognize them, and we recognize them as opportunities to bring him glory. Not opportunities for us to get ahead, to make ourselves look good, but recognize that God is at work in the midst of your crazy mess, and he wants to bring about success, but he wants to do it for his glory so that the kingdom of God can expand and be built when other people hear and see and learn and know what it is that God has done in you and through you, that you would divert all attention back to him so that they could know the source of his greatness and of his goodness in our lives, that Joseph grew in his understanding of what this meant to seize opportunities for God. No matter where you are today, no matter what pit or what difficulty you're going through, God is with you. He alone brings success in your crazy mess for his purposes. Will you seize your opportunities to bring glory to God? Seize them. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We praise you for all that you are doing in our midst, that the Holy Spirit is alive and well, speaking to each and every one here today, God, that for your glory and your honor and your strength and your name and your kingdom being built, we would serve you. We would sacrifice, we would suffer if possible, if necessary, for the sake of your glory, that people might know you. And God, we pray for those who are waiting for deliverance, and we ask, God, that you would reveal yourself to them in their crazy mess, that you would show them who you are, your power and your presence in their lives would change and would grow them in their character, that if they don't know you, that they would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ as their Savior, that they would have hope restored, they have a life redeemed. And God, as we wait in our pits, in the circumstances that we find ourselves in, that we would be people who are looking to bring you glory and to grow into the character of Jesus Christ. And so we ask that you move in powerful ways in hearts and lives today to change us, to change our sight, to change our actions, to be obedient to you in whatever place or mess or circumstances we find ourselves in, so that we can experience what it means to bring glory to your name and your name alone. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we continue in worship? I don't know what circumstances you are going through, but this bridge says that even the darkness running out of an empty grave, the God that was crucified, buried, and rose from the dead is the one that reigns above it all. So I pray that that would be our heart in worship, Lord, that I pray that that is our praise to you this morning. You are the God that reigns above it all, Lord. You reign. You are worthy of it all. So we continue in worship today. Come on. You said the darkness running out of an empty grave. I seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You said the darkness running out of an empty grave. I seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You said the darkness around.
Like Joseph in whatever pit we're in, to the point where we are people who recognize opportunities and seize them to bring glory to God. Can we do that?
Yes.
Have a great day.